Today's topic is business valuation for startups and young growth companies. So let's deep dive into what is valuation first. This is a disclaimer. Now, coming to valuation, what is a valuation? Valuation is nothing but an estimation. What is that you're estimating? It could be value, it could be a future estimate, it could be anything. It is a pure estimation of what would happen in the coming days. So valuation basically is to address the thing between what is present today and what could be the future. It's just a projection. Now, like we human beings age, all corporates have something called as corporate life cycle. When you are a startup, you're just a just born baby. As you grow, you become a young growth company, then you become a mature company, and then there will be corporate. The company will die. That is how the life cycle of a company is. Like human beings, the companies do have a life cycle. This is very important in terms of understanding valuation, because startups will never remain a startup for their entire lifetime. They would transmit from being a very idea-based company to a young growth company, then to a mature company. There is a transformational phase there. So you need to understand which phase of the life cycle are you in. You are in the very ideation stage, you are in the mid stage, you are in the mature stage, or you are in the worst declining stage of your business. Now, so let's imagine a case. All of us, I think, who have joined might are startups and are into business of some kind. Imagine that you started a company with a lakh and you have done your business for about 2 years now and you have made good profit, say 30% margins. So what would be the value of your company now? Would it be just your capital invested plus your profits, or would it be something else? This is the basic question that everybody needs to answer. What is my worth of my company? How do I value my equity? I don't have a job. If you have to go to an investor, you need to first do your valuation. What is the company's value now? I have been running the business. I have a valuable product. Customers have given me proper feedback. Now, before going to fundraising thing, how do I value my company? This is what we will try and address in this session. So your accountant or your CA would say that your value of the company is your profits plus your assets. But they do not factor into the operation, the goodwill of your company, the brand that you have built, what you have done over the period. You might have repaying customers, you may have very good brand, you may have brand recall value, anything of that sort. Today, brand's valuation is the most important thing. Coca-Cola is valued because of Coke. Flipkart is valued because it's Flipkart. So the value of the brand as well as the profits are counted for the valuation. Now let's go into what is a corporate life cycle. See, when you start your business, you are at the starting point, the light bulb moment or the idea moment, where you just got an idea, you wanted to form a company, you formed a company, just open your company, just have an idea, and you have done your market research and you want to prove a particular thing, or you want to establish a particular thing. That is what is called as a startup stage one or a startup company. Once you have an idea and you have a team in place where you can do the business. And second stage comes to young growth companies. Young growth companies are those who have repeat customers, who have businesses, who have running businesses. You have a product which is live in the market. There is a POC, proof of concept established. You have paying customers. Customers are willing to pay you, and then you are doing your business. We will restrict our topic only to these two topics. One is a startup and the young growth company. Because the other things which you do not want to go into for the time, for this presentation at least. Now, this is an important topic given so many startups and young companies are worried as to how to survive this COVID financially. So, this is one of the formulas that was given by Steve Blank, who is one of the very famous authors. He has said that survival depends on the speed of understanding of the situation multiplied by the magnitude of the change or cost-cutting choices that you make multiplied by the speed and time that you take to make decisions. It's a very simple formula. When I read this formula, I thought it should be shared with everybody. See, survival now, in today's thing, you have to survive this period. 2020 has to be survived. Corona has to be survived. Only if your business survives this, you go ahead, do valuations, raise funds, and do everything else. Now, this formula is a very, very useful formula in terms of how you interpret yourself. The first part of it is speed of understanding of situation. Now, everybody knows. You know very well that the situation is not good, business is down, there has been a lockdown for about 40, 50 days, and we do not know what the future has for us. That is the speed of understanding of situation. As a startup, you would have seen that March, April, or say April month, there would have been no sales at all. There might have been customer orders may not come to you. Or May month, you may not have an order. So that is, you have to understand the situation first, the present situation, the present business situation. And you have to estimate the change that you need to make. What is the changes that you need to make? You need to make changes to your business plan. You need to make changes to your projections. What your projection happened, did not happen. What cost cutting you need to do. And the speed and time in which you take a decision. You cannot endlessly wait for the corona to be over to take certain decisions. Now you know that the choices are made. Your problem is understood. The magnitude is also known. Take decisions at the earliest. These three put together will give you an output which will determine where you can go in terms of the company. This. Now, what do you need to look in an external environment? You are a startup. You will be reading newspapers. You will be reading so many things. You need to do these two things first. One is do an external assessment. What is an external assessment? How is the economy doing? What is the GDP growth rate? How is our health of our target market? For example, if I am the consumer of your product, what is my health? Am I actively buying? Am I returning your calls? Am I out of business? Am I doing my service properly? And then explore what are the new emerging markets? What are the new opportunities Corona has thrown? For example, Zoom today is a new emerging market. Nobody knew Zoom before Corona. So same way, you need to invent. You need to invent the market in which, what are the new opportunities that you get in there. And then the last and final thing you need to know is that forecast the recovery date, whether the 17 they will open or not, whether your team members can come and join you, if the customers start buying or not. Then you have to decide. These are the external environment factors that you need to assess. Why this is important? Because you need to first survive this. You need to survive COVID. You need to survive COVID financially to have a good valuation and then go out, raise your funds, chase your dreams, become the next Googles. So understanding external assessment, please do an external assessment. Find out where you are, where your customers are here. Are they buying or not? Are they businesses or not? Then do an internal assessment. Now, from the CFO's perspective, being a CFO myself, I can say this one, that see, the perspective is to prepare an internal assessment. External is not within your control. GDP is not within your control. What the government is going to decide is not within your control. But this is within your control. See, the internal assessment within your control. You know very well what your numbers are. The numbers can be operating numbers like your cash debt. You have to prepare a scenario-based analysis. We suggest you prepare three types of scenario. One is the best case, the other is the base case, and the other is the worst case. Best case means you project everything positively, prepare your internal assessments accordingly to that. Worst case means estimate everything in the possible worst case. Assume that lockdown will end till June, will go till June, you will not have business till June, what do you do? And then in that, given that context, you need to know what your operating numbers are. See, like liquidity, when is the cash out date? How much is the cash balance that I have? What is the runway that I have? How long can I run my business without acquiring new customers or without my customers paying me? Your accounts receivable, your accounts payable, your debtors, how long are they going to take? Earlier, say the customers were paying you 30 days, 40 days, 50 days. Now they're going to pay 90 days, 120 days. Have you factored those things? Your creditors, how do you manage them? How do you manage the payables, accounts payables? What does your sales pipeline look like? Does it look good? You have good orders. Orders can be executed even during the lockdown. And good. Just do the internal assessments. Marketing program spending. This is very important for startups because many startups have a cash burn. What is a cash burn? To acquire customers, you invest a lot of cash or you spend a lot of cash. We call it customer acquisition cost. In this marketing program spending, you need to understand how are you going to market in this new world of post-corona and understand the market dynamics of how your marketing spend is going to be. Are you going to invest in Google? Are you going to invest in your Facebook ads, Insta ads? How are you going to plan? Are your customers going to come through those means? Do a proper internal assessment. And last is your payroll and your other variable cost. Payroll cost, you know how many employees you have, how many staffs you have, how many people you need to make your salaries, how much runway do you have, do you need to cut their salaries, do you need to cut their variable pay, do you need to cut their promotions. Take a call, do an honest internal assessment of the situation. And now since you have done the internal assessment, you would know what your shortfall is, your shortfall of the cash. How do you make good the shortfall of the cash? For example, you may have debt commitments. You can take drawdown more debt. You can say, I don't want any debt. I'll close everything down. But do a honest assessment of your position internally. Where will the additional capital come from? You need capital to survive. Where will the capital come from? Would it be from existing lenders? Would it be from new lenders? What is the source of capital? And if you are a startup, how is your VC or your investor going to look at your company? Is he going to look at your company the way it was looking prior to Corona? Or is it going to change? Are you ready for that? If you want me to invest a crore in your business, has your business plan changed? Has anything changed? Do a proper internal assessment. It is your internal assessment, so you have all the data. Do it. Both these internal assessment and external assessment are very, very critical. When even if you go and pitch for any VC or any seed investment or anything, it is very important that you have done this work. Now, once you have done this, once the post-corona era, what is your new business model? What is your new operating plan? Plans have changed, ideas have changed, things have changed for the good or the bad. So first, make changes, potential changes in your business plan. Where is your customer? Has your customer's mindset changed? Have you changed? Is there anything that you need to do different to the market? Do you need to give them more access? Do you need to give them more discounts? Do you need to give them more, whatever it is, any benefits to get the customer back? Ask yourself, are there new customers? What new customers can you get? How can you get them? What is the source? The new normal is going to be, there is a saying, after every recession, there are new millionaires and billionaires that are being made. This recession and this great depression that is going to come is no different. These are going to be startups that are going to survive this. People are going to survive this. And they are going to be the next level growth companies for the next millionaires and billionaires that are being formed. Many companies, unfortunately, will vanish. But if you do the previous mentioned steps, if you do your planning, and if you pivot to a new stage, say you have discovered a new business model, or you discover something new, you will definitely survive. And once this all gets over, once the dust gets settled, you will definitely overcome this and you'll become a much better business, the new next unicorns of India. Last, do a sensitivity analysis and scenario-based financial modeling analysis. Now, what is a sensitivity analysis? Sensitivity analysis is a change of a particular item to a change of your output. For example, currently you are selling a product at 100 rupees, your margin is 30 rupees. So for selling 100 rupees, you're getting 30 rupees. You do a sensitivity analysis. What if my profit margin comes down to 10%? What if I have to cut down my cost from 70 rupees to 60 rupees? What if I have to cut down my labor cost? What if I have to do this? Do a proper sensitivity analysis as to a change in a particular variable, how is it going to impact your business? How is it going to impact your valuations? And how it is going to impact your financial future. Scenario-based modeling, as I told you, you have to prepare three scenarios. One is the worst case scenario, one is the base case scenario, other is the optimistic scenario. Do your assumptions, do your maths. You know the cost of a product, you know the cost of your services, you know the cost of marketing, you know your labor cost. Everything is known. Prepare it for three stages. Worst case, base case, and the best case also. You will arrive at a conclusion as to where you stand, both in financial terms as well as when you go out for valuation and doing business. Last, this is one of the things which many people asked me, should I draw debt or should I borrow more money now to survive or should I repay all the debt? It depends on the business nature. If your business, you feel that there's going to be a business future, you can feel that there's going to be business. See, you need capital for that, draw down all your debts. First thing is that you have to survive to do anything. If you shut everything down, if you completely shut down the funding routes, taps, you will not survive it. Make an honest assessment. Based on the previous two things, your internal and external assessment, you would be in a position to judge whether you need to be drawing down more debts or don't draw down more debts. Depends on the product. If your product has become obsolete, and don't do it. If you're pivoting to new businesses and you feel that there's a market for that business, obviously draw down debt. Get debt in your books. Try and run your business. Try and get your capital going. You need to call on your existing vendors, your all parties and your bankers and call them and ask them for credit. This is a situation you need credit both for working capital as well as for growth. In valuation, we call when we invest money only for the growth capital, not for the existing capital. Whatever you have generated is over. It's done history. Valuation is done for your growth capital. What is your growth? And is my money put to growth or is my money put to pay my existing vendors and other liabilities? Nothing is more important than assuring your employees. Everybody knows that your salary being paid by the employer is one of the major criteria for your team members to be on board with you. Without a team, nothing works. We'll see that in the coming slides as to what a successful startup looks like. And the team is the core pillar of it. Nothing else beats. So ensure that you assure your employees that salaries would be paid. Whether you cut down your salary, don't cut your salaries, it's up to you. But assure them. Now, this is very important in terms of where we are. Till date, we were doing business as it was. We had our thoughts, we were doing it. Now has come a stage where we are in a pre-post-corona era. The post-corona era, those who have adopted technology, those who have embraced technology, those who have added technology to their business are going to survive. If you're doing your business in old way, you may not get funded. There may be difficulty in doing what you're doing. This is the Rogers technology adoption curve. You need to adopt technology in whatever way possible. That is the only way to survive COVID-19. Like we're adopting Zoom for video conferencing or any other technology platform that we use for communicating or otherwise. So you have to adopt technology. That should be one of your part of your internal assessment. And how you fit into this, it's up to every business to decide based on their business plans, based on their planning, future plans, what they want. But the post-corona era, it's going to be only technology driven. We may not have physical meetings, we may only have Zoom meetings or Hangouts. Please be ready with that. Please be ready with it and please check where you found. I want everybody to be in the early adopter stage. Adopt new technology. Adopt. There are so many technologies available. Adopt it. This will save you cost. This will save you the when you pitch to your investor. This will give more value add to you saying that, you know, this technology is being adopted. I adopt blockchain technology. The investors would be overwhelmed when they see that you are adopting technology. Now, we have seen the thing of surviving COVID-19, which I thought was very important to be discussed with all the startups. Now, let's look at what investors are looking for in a startup before investing. As a startup, have you assessed the following? Did you assess something? Did you assess who is your target ideal customer? Now, in the post-COVID era, post-corona era, post-COVID era, your ideal customer might have changed. Your ideal customer's mentality might have changed. Have you assessed your ideal target customer? Have you done a reassessment? Are you clear as to what you're doing? Next important thing is your management team. That is your co-founders, your employees, and everything, and the knowledge that they bring to the table. This is very important. Funding happens on the face value of the founders, co-founders. Idea is secondary, management team is the primary. Next is your total addressable market. Total addressable market is something where you have a particular set. You say, for example, you're selling groceries online. You have a particular set. You only sell in, say, Delhi, a particular place in Delhi. That is your market. That is your total accessible market. That is a total addressable market. Every business has its own total addressable market. Have you found it? If you have not found it, do research, find your total addressable market. And the next step is that you need to find what percentage of your total addressable market can you capture in the next 3 to 5 years? Now in the post this COVID, markets will open up, people will open up, people will start buying. But what is your total addressable market? What have you done? What percentage of it? Say for example, in Delhi, a particular area, say the number of customer volume is 100 crores. What percentage of that business can you get? That is your percentage of your total addressable market. Do not do it for 20 years, 30 years projection. Do it for 3 to 5 years as a basis. You would get your total addressable market. Once you have got all these things, next is that do a honest assessment of your competition level. Who is your competitor? What is the pricing strategy? What is the marketing strategy? Where are they good? Where are they bad? What have you done in order to get your products better? Be honest with yourself. This is your internal assessment. Just do your honest assessment. If you say there is no competition, somebody is going to come and kill you. So do a honest assessment. Do a planned honest assessment of what your competition level is in terms of your total addressable market. Next is, do you have a go-to-market strategy? Do you have a good marketing plan? Do you have a business plan? Do you know where to target, whom to target, how to sell? That is your go-to-market strategy. Next comes your minimum viable product. What is a minimum viable product? Minimum viable product is a product where you have done your beta testing. For example, you have an app. You cannot publish the app till it's completed. It's not the case. You have to publish the app at a beta stage, get the feedback, get customers' feedback, get people's feedback, reiterate your business model, change your business model, change your pricing, change your marketing strategy. Then you come to the minimum viable product. Once you do all these things, the investors are now looking for proof of concept. What is the proof of concept? Is that you have tested this product in the market. I have a product, I have an app, I've gone to the market, I've checked it up with the market, customers have given me a good feedback. Or customer wants this feature to be added. Or this wants it to be added. Now Facebook is allowing 8 people to join, sorry, WhatsApp is allowing 8 people to join in a conference call. That is because customers are moving towards Zoom, so WhatsApp had to do something. They said 8 people can be joined in a video call. That is a change, that is a proof of concept. I'm just giving a very example of that. There could be many things that you can change, and you have to give a proof of concept that the market is willing to accept your product. Market is willing to accept your product. Then, if you are looking for investor funding, then you have your business has to be having an exponential growth. It cannot be year on year growth of 10%, 20%. It has to be 2x, 3x, 300%, 400% growth year on year for them to be invested in your company and for them to unlock their value in you. End of the day, investors' responsibility is getting somebody else's funds, investing in your company, getting the returns, getting their margins and paying it back to the original investors. So you have to be giving, and the failure rate in startups is about 8 or 9 in 10 startups fail in the first 3 years to 5 years. This is the market study that has been done. So their risk of failure is high. So their return is also exponentially higher. You have to give them 200x, 300x growth, 100%, 200% growth. You have to give them growth. Then only they'll be investing in your company. Now, what investors are looking for in a pictorial format is that you need a 3 to 5 years future business financials. Like I told you before, plan it properly, draft it, put your mind in it, get every cost details, minute cost details possible. Get every customer acquisition cost possible. That is for you to run your business. What would be your sales in the first 3 to 5 years? What would be your cost in the first 5 years? What would be my employee cost in the next 3 years? What would be my other cost in my 3 years? What could be my customer acquisition cost in the next 2 to 3 to 5 years? Then assess the amount of funding needed. Now, when I go through the presentation, I'll tell you what is the cash flow gap, where you can say the amount of funding needed can be ascertained when you prepare this 3 to 5 year business plan. You will get to know, this is the cash I need. I don't have so much cash, so I need investors to fund me at least X amount of cash. And lastly, you have to decide what percentage of equity stake are you going to give to your investor. This is very important because I as an investor would invest only in companies which are giving me reasonable stake in the company. If you give me 2%, 3%, I would say no. Why is this important? At early stage startups or only startups which have ideas, the minimum in angel or the seed fund would expect is 20-30%. This is the market thing. It would be lower if you have an exponentially good idea and your idea is never tested before. But other than that, general trend in the market is 20-30%. Now, what is a successful startup? As I told you in the previous slides, a successful startup, VCs invest in people more than ideas. That is, teams with entrepreneurs who are either funded before or have good background of the business, have proved something to the world, or their ideas are so unique and they have passion and drive of doing. Business is nothing but people driving it. So the team is the most important factor. Everybody might have an idea, but is the team committed to the idea? Is the team willing to change? Now COVID has come. Is the team willing to adapt to the new changes? Is the team doing all the changes? This is what they are looking for. Are you in the long run of the game, or are you in the short run of the game that just form a company, just try and do it and bust out? This is very important for all startups to understand the team. And the best composition of team would be two co-founders, different varying levels, and a tech member in the team. It's an ideal structure of a team. Ideal structure. Not necessarily that it has to be followed, but an ideal structure that every start investor looks at is, does a team have a person who has specialized knowledge in what they are doing? Does the team have specialized knowledge on, say, accounting, marketing? Does your team have a CFO or someone? And does your team have a technology person? Does your team have a technology person? Because now technology is a part, integral part. Do you have a technology? This is the best ideal team structure. Now, you need to be people, especially those who can implement. People have to implement your ideas. It's not paper ideas will not work. You cannot be paper tiger. You have to implement the ideas. The moment you start implementing, you will not find that thing easy, because you will find a lot of challenges. What you planned may not happen. Your sales may not be there. There could be COVID 2.0, COVID 3.0. Anything could happen. The business will be disrupted. Business will be booming. So be prepared for the cycle. Now, the next thing is you are hitting the right ROIs. ROI is nothing but return on investment. See, all your investors are looking for return on investments. You are doing a business because you need return on investments. If you have invested 1 lakh, you need at least 25% margin on your product, at least 30% margin on your product. That is your return on investment. The same way when an investor invests in your company, he needs his margin. He needs 30%, 40%, 50%. Based on the level of risk that he is taking. Investor is investing only in an idea. He is taking a lot of risk. So he needs more return. Even if you fail, he needs to other companies to cope up with the return that has been missed by your company. So have the attitude of right ROI in mind. So return on investment, how will that be? When will my company be profitable? Profitable means cash profits. So be clear from day one that your ROIs matter, both for you as well as for your investor, as for any business. Business runs on ROIs. We do not run a charitable institution. We're not an NGO to give free of cost service to anybody. So we run business on a particular ROI on margins. So the third point is very, very important for startups who are looking for funding or for good value. That is scalability. If your product is not scalable, venture capitalists or thing will not invest in your business. Look whether it is scalable or not. Scalability means, can I have 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 10,000 customers at a time without having any hassle? Can I do that? Is my business scalable? If your business is not scalable, if it is not scalable, it is a manual operation, it is definitely not scalable, then investors' interest in your company would not be that much. I will give you an example of, say, Byju's. Byju's has so many customers, they can scale it out. Left, right, center, they can scale the business. It's just that they have to invest cost on marketing, and they'll get their customers. Are you in a position to scale up your company? Be it COVID, no COVID. Then, other thing is that you should have credible ideas and credible people. You should have credible ideas from and to their ecosystem, and how you are going to get to that solution. If you are giving a particular solution to a problem that you have identified, how are you going to go from point A to point N? How are you going to unlock value? This is very important. And when this is very, the thing is, last point is, you have to prepare your financials and operating plans that are realistic. prepare it as realistically as possible. As I told you earlier, prepare it in three methods. One is your best case, worst case, and the most awful case possible, perhaps a COVID case. So prepare it in all the three methods, three types. See where you stand internally. You don't have to disclose it to the investors, but you yourself assure yourself that where we stand in terms of the financials. When you present the financials or when you present the valuation to the investor, have a good operating business plan, have a good realistic financial modeling done, and have a good roadmap for their exit also. That way they will invest in your company. This is how successful startups are made. This is how this will determine whether you're the next Google, you're the next Zoho, you're the next Flipkart, or whomsoever it is. Now, this is a 7-step business finance framework. Why do you call 7-step business finance framework? Is that what we discussed earlier is what we are still continuing to discuss here. The first part is that, as I told you earlier, forecast your revenues. Now, how do you forecast your revenues? Year on year, prepare a sheet, product wise, item wise, purchase price, your selling price, your gross margin. Prepare item wise sales, item wise services. If you are into technology company, how am I going to access the customer? How am I going to get the user? What is the value per user? So prepare your sales revenue forecast. Product wise, then forecast your cost. Your cost includes everything, your salaries, your expenses, your interest. Your, as a promoter, you will also want to draw some salary from your business. Draw salary from your business. Mark it as a cost. Then forecast your investments. What is your investments for running a business? You need certain assets. You need computers. You need an office room. You need whatever it is for you to run the business, a server. Just estimate those assets that you need. Just estimate. And what is the year-on-year increase that you need for those assets? Just estimate it properly. Then assess your own financing. This is very, very important. Many people think that you can go out on the market, go to the investor, they'll fund you for your ideas. No. Assess your own financing first. This we call as bootstrapping. Do a bootstrapping. Infosys, when it was formed, did not go for any investor till they went for an IPO. Zoho does not go for any investor. They are self-funded companies. Assess your own financing. What is the capital that I am willing to put in the business? What is there in the business for me? And how I can grow it? Do I need investor in my business or not? A test to this, you need to have this test of scalability. Is your business scalable? If it is scalable, then go. Or your product is very good, then go. You should try it better. Then next come the preparation of your income statement and your balance sheets. Income statement is nothing but your profit and loss and your balance sheet. Profit and loss gives you the net profit of the company, and your balance sheet gives you the financial position of the company. Prepare your income statement, P&L, and balance sheet. If you're not able to do it, get in touch with your CAs or valuation professionals. They will help you how to prepare your balance sheet and your profit and loss account. Now comes the critical part. Estimating your funding gap. Now, what is the funding gap? For example, in year one, I did a business of 1 lakh. I had a profit of 20,000 and a cash balance sitting in my book is 20,000. Next year, I have to do a sales of 10 lakhs. For doing sales of 10 lakhs, I need to incur marketing cost of 20 lakhs. Assuming you're a growth company, you want to grow as a startup, you're willing to take on losses. Now my sales is 10 lakhs, my operating cost is 8 lakhs, my margin is only 2 lakhs there. And my other cost, my marketing customer acquisition cost, another 10 lakhs. So I need 1 lakhs, that is my funding gap. Or I'll put it very simply, my sales in year 1 is 10 lakhs, my cost is 8 lakhs, my profit is 2 lakhs. Year 2, I want to make the sales to 20 lakhs. My cost remains at around 12 lakhs. Additionally, to get me from 10 lakh to 20 lakh, I have to get new customers for which I have to spend an additional 10 lakhs. So already your costing is 12, new cost you're incurring is around 10, the sales is 20, balance is 2 lakhs that you need it as. You need to be in a position to estimate your funding gap, get your funding gap right. What is the cash shortage that you have in your business? And how the cash shortage can be met? It can be through bank loan, it can be through investor funding, it can be through any means. Once you have done all these 6 steps, then comes business valuation. Do the valuation of your company. Once this is arrived, in the coming slides, I'll tell you what it might be more theoretical in some ways, but let's go ahead and decide what how evaluation of company is done. So this is the 7-step business framework that you need to have. This is very critical. Given this COVID context, be very critical as to how you are projecting these 7 steps. This is going to determine whether you're funded or not. Your business survival depends on these 7 steps. So do it properly. Do a honest assessment, internal assessment to yourself. Now, what are financial drivers? As I told you here, you need to bootstrap your business. You need to bootstrap your business. You need to assess your own funding. That is bootstrapping. So what are the financial drivers that are there? You could raise your own funds. How? You could have your own savings. You could have your own. You could go to your friends, family, relatives. This is the first step in any business. Who is going to support your idea? It's going to be your family. It's going to be yourself. Are you willing to put in that money? As an investor, I would see, are you willing to invest money in your business first? Are you willing to take the risk first? Are you willing to take the plunge in the business first? Are you putting your money at risk first? If you don't put your money at risk and you expect other people's money to be put at risk, you need to be very good in explaining to them the way it is. But generally, it works that way, that how good are you in your investing your own money? Your own money could be your personal savings, your friends, family, relatives, your short-term loans and long-term loans that you can get. This is very important. This stage of the business is the ideation stage where the company is getting bootstrapped. Do bootstrapping. Get your business idea, start it, put in your capital, get it to the market. As I told you, get the POC, proof of concept in the market, then go to the investor. The investor will say, okay, I'll invest. If you don't do any of these things, it's going to be your paper on which is going to invest. Now coming to the main topic of business valuation approaches. See, there could be two approaches in business valuation. One is the pure negotiation approach. Other is the methods. There are too many methods in which a business can be valued. For young and early stage startups, the only method that is applied is pure negotiation approach. That is, you go, you negotiate, you sell, my value of my business is 10 lakhs. I'm going to give you so much shares. Are you interested? This is pure negotiation. Nothing, it is just based on your ideas. The ideas validated by the founder, the ideas validated by the investors. Now, in pure negotiation methods, let's assume that your funding requirement is 1.35 million or 13.5 lakhs. How much equity dilution should you give to your investor? This is most important. In a pure negotiation, this is what happens for all young and early stage startups. For them, valuation does not matter that much. Valuation is what is pure negotiation based. If I tell my company's value is say 1 crore and you tell your company's value is 80 lakhs and we both agree to a mutual value of 90 lakhs, the value of the company is 90 lakhs, as simple as that. It is pure negotiation approach. This is done for early stage startups. Young startups which do not have financials, which do not have numbers, this is the way things happen when investment goes on. Now, the pure negotiation amount, you need to first, as I told you in the previous slides, amount of funding needed. What is the amount of funding that you need? You need to do a proper planning and assessment of amount of funding that is needed. Once you know the amount of funding that is needed, what is the percentage of equity are you willing to offer to the investors? What is the percentage of equity that you're willing to offer to the investors? You need to decide both of these things. This is very important. How you could decide this? You can talk to other friends, you can talk to your peer members, you can negotiate, you can discuss, but don't be rigid in this. You have an idea, the other investor is taking risk on your idea. So just be frugal in this and try and get the best possible out of that one. Now, in a pure thing, this is how the valuation works. I need a funding of 13.5 lakhs or 1.35 million, and I'm willing to offer you 25% equity that you have decided. The value of the company would be 5.4 million, that is 54 lakhs. This is as simple as pure negotiation, nothing. You need 20 lakhs, you are willing to give me 25%. So what is the value of the company? That is pure negotiation based approach. There's nothing involved in this. Early stage startups, please be, this is how it works. But you need to have a very clear business plan, you need to have a very clear P&L balance sheet and valuation done to arrive at this figure. When you go to the investor and check to them, you can say, boss, my business could be valued at so much. Don't give me, I will not give you 20%. I'll only give you 10%. My growth rate is going to be 100x. So I will not give you 25%. I'll give you only 2%. you negotiate. That is pure negotiation based approach. Next is the methods where we value, say, a growth company or a startup which has now grown and become a growth company, say a Flipkart, say a Myntra, say any other company that you want, say values. How do we do that? There are two methods. One is the cash flow based approach, other is the exit multiple based approach. Now, the first method is called as a discounted free cash flow method. From here onwards, it could be more theoretical, it could be more, you may not be able to push it to comprehend is what we saying, but it's better to understand how the process works. Now, the free cash flow to equity investor is something which every company does a valuation on. It is the cash that is available for the equity shareholders. Equity shareholders are the shareholders who own the company. This is one method of valuation. And exit multiple valuation. Exit multiple valuation is simple. You figure out that in 5 years, my business is worth 5 crores. And today I'm willing to give 20% based on that valuation. That is exit multiple. You need to understand that every investor has a return on investment. And as per market study, for every investor investing in a startup or a young growth company, their return on investment should be at least 60-70%. This is done because they have to take the risk, higher risk, if your business fails or your idea fails. So keep this in mind, and then we'll go ahead with the topic. This is the most important aspect of any valuation. What is a pre-money valuation? What is a post-money valuation? Pre-money valuation is nothing but value of the company before investment. Let's take this example for that. In this case, my pre-money valuation is that I need 1.35 million or 13.5 lakhs. And the post-money valuation is 5.4 million. This is the pre-money, this is the post-money. When you go for approach an investor, make sure that you get your pre-money figures right. That is the determining basis on which your post-money valuation works. I've given a very clear example here. Post-money valuation is equal to value of a company before the investment plus the amount of investment. So let's take two cases here. The two investors are offering you two different things. One is an investor, one is offering you 25,000 for 20% of your business, other investor is offering 1,50,000 of your business. In this case, what is your pre-money and what is your post-money? Under negotiated approach, post-money valuation is known. You are getting 25,000 for 20% of your business. The post-money valuation is 25,000 divided by 20% gives you 1,25,000. The value of your company is 1,25,000. The pre-money valuation would be 1,25,000 minus 25,000, which is 1,00,000. Pre-money valuation is 1,00,000 here, and 1,25,000 is your post-money valuation. That's given by the formula. Pre-money value of the company before investment plus the amount of investment. This is how pre-money and post-money works. When you are drafting your time term sheet, please be very clear with what is your pre-money valuations. First, that is going to be the basis on which the funding is going to happen. The second case on the similar, I'll give another example. 1,50,000 of the business. Post-money valuation is 2 lakhs because 1 lakh divided by 50% gives you 2 lakhs. And the pre-money valuation is again 1,00,000. This is how when an investor says this is pre-money, this is post-money, this is how the valuation works. This is how the formula works. Now, this is going to be more technical in nature, but when Facebook decides to invest in Jio, on what basis do they decide? They decide on the basis of the future cash flows, future earning ability. Future EBITDA. EBITDA is nothing but earning before interest and tax. This is the formula in which a free cash flow to the firm is arrived. It might be more technical, but this is the general formula. How it is arrived? You get your EBITDA, earnings before interest and tax, add back all your depreciation that are there because it's non-cash. Add back your capital expenditure that you need. Capital expenditure is your future investment needed to grow the company. And add non-cash change in the working capital, your debtors, your creditors, your adjustment, you add it. This is very important in terms of understanding the subject, estimating the cost of equity. You started a company with a minimum required return on investment. I need 30% return, I need 50% return, I need 70%. How is that return going? For which we'll take this case. You started a company with the intention of return on capital that you have employed. Bank FD gives you 5% return. and your business gives you 30% return. How do you calculate your cost of equity? For doing your business, you are investing a particular amount of money in your business. If you had borrowed that money, you would have paid 10-20% interest. If you are investing your own money, what is the value of return on investment that you are getting? There are multiple methods of how you can arrive at cost of equity. Today, I don't think for startups and young startups, it's not that much relevant, but it is very important to understand that if you are investing a lakh of your own money into your business, you need return on those investments. If you had borrowed that money, you would have paid interest. If you are investing your own money, you also need a return on that. How is that calculated? It is calculated based on this formula, which is risk-free rate of return plus beta into market return minus risk-free rate of return. This will, every business for that matter, if I keep the money idle in my bank, then I would get 5% every. So better to be 5% will there. Then I am investing in a business for which I am taking a particular risk. The risk is being factored into the beta. Then comes the market return. If I do a business, if I invest my time, energy, money, I need 30% return. That is your market rate of return. Now your cost of equity or cost of doing your investment in there is given by this formula. That is risk-free rate plus beta into market rate of return minus the risk-free rate. We'll see how that works out. This is again a continuation of the part. How do you estimate risk? As I told you earlier, beta is your risk. For doing business, there could be uncertainty, there could be COVID, there could be COVID-1, wave 1, wave 2, wave 100, whatever it is. How do you assess that risk? Risk is negative, and this is given by one of the very famous authors on an expert gurus on valuation, Mr. Ashwath Damodar. Risk is denoted by this symbol. The meaning of the symbol is one for danger, second is for opportunities. Same thing applies in COVID also. There is danger of COVID, there is opportunities in COVID also. How do we assess this risk? We as valuation professionals have certain metrics. For example, if it's a young growth company, your risk is much higher because your ideas may fail, your process may fail, your planning may fail, anything could have been gone wrong. So we estimate the risk based on market potential of your business. If you are a startup, it is tough. We will give the risk on a higher side. We'll give beta a higher side. So now, then you come at exit value of the terminal value. The terminal value, the value of the company, if your company goes on to perpetuity, that is, it has an infinite life. All valuations are done on one presumption, that your company would continue endlessly. We call that as going concern. There is not going to be any stoppage in the company. So in that basis, how do you value the end value of your company or the terminal value of your company? This is given by this formula. I don't think that you need an explanation for this thing. Just there to understand that when you see a valuation, when I will show you a valuation of a company, I don't want to disclose the name of the company, but when I show you, these and all would be terminals that would be there. Just for you to understand what these are, just going through this. As I told you in the previous slide, the 7-step business process, we have estimated a 5-year sales of a particular company. I'm not disclosing the name. I've told you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 as a line item of sales. This is the year 20, 21, 22, 23, 24 sales item. This could be my total revenue. This is how you project your revenues. This is how you project your sales item wise. This is the sales item that you have versus the year on year increase that you're going to give, you're going to estimate. Next comes your estimating your future expenses. You could have many expenses, you could have anything. All these expenses, put it down, get the expenses, narrow it down. This is the total expenditure that I'll do. I'm not going to item by item, but just for an illustrative purpose. Now estimating the P&L. This is how your P&L will look at. Earnings before interest and tax, your finance cost. Finance cost is nothing but your debt, interest that you pay. If you have borrowed any capital, you will pay interest. That is the finance cost. This is earnings before interest and tax, EBITDA. This is your tax rate. This is your net taxable income. This is net income that the company makes. This is the net income that the company makes. You have to make it. I understand it might be. This is how we prepare it. Then, as I told you in the previous slides, the estimating the free cash flow to the equity. This is how it is done. We get the net income, add back the depreciation. Changes in working capital is added back, your capital expenditure is added back. Do you need to raise any debt or capital is accounted here, and then you arrive at the free cash flow to equity shareholder. This is how the free cash flow to equity shareholders is arrived. You, in the previous slide, we saw there's something called as a risk and how we assess a beta. Now, in this case, we are assessing the beta. We will assume for this is the risk-free rate. Risk-free rate, 10-year Government of India bonds now gives you 7.4%. That means if you go, and this may not be updated for the current date, just giving you, take it as an illustrative purpose. If you keep your money idle and keep it in Government of India bonds, you're going to earn 7%. And if I invest in riskier businesses, if I invest in, say, Sensex in the stock market, it is going to give me another 10% growth. It is going to give me an additional 10% return on investment. By the way, average return on stock market for any investors could be between 50 to 20% per year. So on that assumption, the equity risk premium is nothing but the, because I'm taking this risk, I need more returns. If I keep my funds idle, I'll get 7.5%, 7.2%. Because I'm taking that risk, I need another 7.14% to get. Then comes your beta. These two are assessed, then comes your beta. Beta is a valuation that you do for risk. My risk is 1.24 times, or my chances of failure. This could be 1.24, this could be 1, this could be 0.5, depends on the life cycle of the company. If you're a young company, the beta could be 2, 3 also. As the beta increases, your cost of equity also increases. In this given case, we have taken 1.24%. The cost of equity is 16.6%. What is the 16.6%? 16.6% is the amount of investment return that you need in your business. For your 1 lakh that you invest in your company, you need at least 16.6% return. At least 16.6% return. If I had kept it idle, I would have got 7.5. For taking this risk and doing this, I need at least 16.6% as a return on my capital invested. This is how an investor will also look at his investments. Now, I'm just giving you a basic example of how the valuation is done. You have estimated the free cash flow. You have estimated the terminal cash flow. As I told you earlier, again, terminal cash flow is the value of the continuing business. After 2023 or 2024, the business is going to continue. The business is going to extend. Business will run. What is the value of that? You don't form a company to shut it down in 1 year or 2 years. You expect the company to become the next Facebook, the next Google, the next whatever it is, next Goldman Sachs, next Citibank, whatever it is. It's going to last for centuries to come, 100 years, 150 years, 200 years. So given that, this value is the terminal value or the exit value. For startups, this could be for 5 years. In 5 years, I want to exit the company, then you can prepare the terminal value only for 5 years. Now, terminal growth rate, I think this becomes more complicated for you to understand beyond this. But if you have understood till here, I think the thing of valuation is covered. You need to be very clear with what is a negotiated approach and how we go ahead with the valuation. And this is very important. What is the pre-money and post-money? And what's in the game for you? How do you expect us to ascertain your return on investment? That is the cost of equity. This one. This is very important because as a business, since everybody is in the business, whether you raise funds, you don't raise funds, it is important that you ascertain what is the return that you need on the investment for doing the business that you're doing. I think I have covered all the topics here. I think some the information was useful and you found it useful. Back to you, Sunali. Thank you all. Any questions, please?
Thank you so much, Viswanathan. Your session, it was really very insightful and very informative. So I'm sure it added value to a lot of the attendees present. We have a few questions lined up. Would you like me to read out the questions to you?
Yeah, please.
Great. So one of the question is, so you have the example of Flipkart. To most of us, these type of brands are not making money. But there's still a huge valuation that says Walmart bought into it. So how does one arrive at the valuation?
Flipkart had given a valuation as I showed the cash flow to you. I'll just quickly go back to my slide. The Flipkart had given a valuation or the cash flow projection till 2045. They have given a projection for 35 years. And they have estimated that the market share, the barriers to entry, that is, people cannot start another Flipkart that easily. There is entry barriers, huge cost, because they are not doing it profit, they're doing it at cost. They are acquiring market. So they would turn profitable by 2025, 2030. And by 2045, they would have had 45% of the India's overall gross merchandise value. They would have 45% of it. That is how we were valued at $21 billion Walmart. And Walmart, why Walmart had to acquire? There's an interesting story behind this. Walmart was a dying company. Amazon was eating their things. Walmart grew, went through the life cycle. Like, I'll just show the life cycle. And since the Flipkart example is taken up, if you have time, just complete this one. Walmart was in the decline phase. Walmart was a retailer who was a chain retailer like Big Bazaar in India, gave discounts, killed all the small markets, captured all the markets. Now Amazon is doing the same to them through e-commerce and groceries. So Walmart was a declining company. They had to do something to come up with this. They did not have the capacity to build the new structure, get it up. So what Walmart paid for Flipkart was, Walmart paid for the technology, and Walmart even paid for their three companies. PhonePe is owned by Flipkart, Myntra is owned by Flipkart. The valuation of $21 billion that they got is for all the three companies put together. So you value a company at around $7 billion. So PhonePe, you have market, you have data, you have customer behavior, you have the entire ecosystem with you. There is no third-party competition. There are only two players. Snapdeal is out. There are only two players. So that is how the valuation was arrived. They had given the valuation to 2045. And then the profitability would be much later, because competition is heavy. There's going to be huge cash burns. And that is how the Flipkart's valuation was done. I hope that I answered the question.
Yes, absolutely. So the next question is from Mr. Ajit Kumar Shah. He says, any company takes a 5-year projection for valuation of the company, valuation work on FCF, for generating positive FCF in that cash, can we take a provision of our tax payment in our balance sheet till the fifth year, like the final year?
I'm not able to follow your question, sorry. Can you just repeat the question?
Yeah, of course. So it's actually the first question in the Q&A section, if you just see.
Can you just repeat it? It will be great. I'll just answer.
Sorry?
I'm not able to get this in my panel, Q&A panel. Can you explain the last slide? Innovation?
That's fine. So we can take another question until then. One question we have from Mr. Akshat Shetty. He says, legally, who is authorized to make a valuation to a startup? Are CAs with 10 plus years of experience allowed? Or we need a merchant banker to do it? Is it mandatory?
In 2017, the rules were amended. There's something called as registered valuers rules. Your company's valuation has to be done, at least for startup, has to be done by a registered valuer. A registered valuer could be a CA, could be a company secretary, could be from any profession, but he needs to be a registered valuer. And only a registered valuer can do valuation under the Companies Act. It's not. You need to have at least 4+ years of experience, and then that's how the valuation happens. And from 2017 onwards, it's not necessary that merchant bankers should do the valuation. Anybody, any registered valuer who is registered, who has to qualify for a particular exam, he can, once he has a certificate of practice, he can issue the valuation.
The next question is from Mr. Karan Garg. He says, if one has to sell a mature company and want an exit, what's the best way to go about it?
you are a mature company, the company is matured and the life cycle is crossed. Maturity can happen in multiple stages. Say, for example, for mature companies, I would call it, say, General Electric, GE, US company. They founded in 1900s. Now the company has died down, they've diversified, they've come to a position where they cannot further grow the business. The growth is negative. Market size, the total addressable market is being captured. You don't have further growth that is called a mature company. Exits for a mature company depends on where they are, whether they are listed, they are unlisted, what is the proposition. If it's a mature company, better stay out. Investors don't go into mature companies because there's no growth. You cannot grow. Growth is zero or growth is negative. And you enter the decline phase. So exit for you would be typically an IPO if you have an option, or if you find a very good investor who wants your brand name, sell the brand name.
Great. So the next question is from Mr. Mohammed. He says, what are the elements we consider for pre-money evaluation?
Pre-money evaluation, as I told you, let me just go back to the slide. Element is nothing but pre-money valuation depends on the value of your cash flows. As I showed you here, last slide, you can see. You have estimated everything, you have estimated the entire thing. The present value of a business, the present value of a business that is being shown here is the pre-money valuation. You do not have this is done basis that there is no investment in the business. So the factors to be considered in a pre-money valuation is if you have done your homework well, if you have done your P&L balance sheet projections well, if you have done your everything well, and you have arrived at a net present value of the company, this could be the basis of your pre-money valuation. This plus what is being invested could be the pre-money valuation. And what goes into it? The 7-step process, what is your business in that?
So the next question is from Mr. Ajit again. He says, if any company is working for social impact to a village or a person, how to calculate goodwill and other benefits to increase the valuation of the company?
See, when you're doing a service as an NGO or you're doing for non-for-profit, your valuation typically will not be basis the this one. We call it the economic benefit of it. But NGOs are not valued on the way their profitable companies are valued. If you're doing a service, then DCF method may not be the appropriate method for you. You will have to see at what is the economic impact that you're creating. How many lives are you transforming? What are you doing? You are doing it not for profit, but only as a service. So there's no way an investor is going to gain a return on that. So I think the question is that then that is the valuation cannot be done on these basis. It has to be done on the economic impact that you create.
Question is from Mr. Akshay Raina. He says, how is valuation of brand image done?
Brand valuation is a complete topic in itself. Brand valuation is done based on the brand recall value, what we call as a recall value. How fast are you able to call back the value? For example, if I'm able to call BizX or if I'm able to call Franchise India easily, that is a brand value. There's a value associated. If I'm able to call back Flipkart without me doing anything, that is brand recall value. Valuation happens on a method in which we ascertain for that value what is that people are coming for. For example, say Google, LinkedIn, all are based on brand valuation. Their revenues may be much lower, but the valuation is done on the brand. It happens on what we call as a super profit method. How Walmart acquired Flipkart also was on that particular method, where the valuation happened based on the brand. Brand has a particular goodwill, and that goodwill has a potential to generate future profits for me. Multiple profits for me. So there's no competition in that segment. That is how the brand valuation is done. The same formula which is used above will be used. The differential methods.
So the next question is from Mr. Neeraj Gupta. He says, if in a company that we are planning to buy, there's a dependency on the skills of the current owners, should we buy it?
That depends. Any business takeovers or any buyout happens is that there is an agreement in which the promoters stay with the company for the next 1 to 2 years. Wherein you plan a clear exit plan and they hand over everything in room. Exit does not happen overnight where the existing stakeholders are thrown out or the existing promoters are thrown out and new people come. That will not happen that way. There will be a runway of at least 1 to 1.5 years, 2 years for the business to stabilize. you'll be able to stabilize. And if you're looking to buy a company, you have an agreement in such a way that the co-founders be with the company for the next 1 or 2 years till you stabilize or you understand the business properly.
So the next question is from Mr. Karan Garg. He says, from an angel investor's point of view, what things one needs to watch out while they are investing to get a smooth exit at the end?
Investor's point of view to get a smooth exit is that it depends on the investor, the appetite that they have. See, once you get an investor on board, you're getting two things. One is you're getting their financial and their knowledge part also along. So both being combined, they know, they will guide you how to get your market access. They will guide you as to how to do it. But if your market fails the test or your product is too mature, or mature in the sense that it is out of line, the product that should come in 2030 is coming in 2020, it will be out. It is pretty, you are just futuristic technology imported now, it will also be out because people will not embrace those changes. So it is a very path that you will adopt where you will gradually get it. You will gradually build your business. And for PE firms and for investment firms, they know when to give an exit. For you as a founder, it is important from a founder's perspective to get the your investors on board, get the next investor on board, because for them the exit happens only when the next round of funding happens. So you have to get the limelight, you have to get the, I think that's what about for investors as such.
So the next question is from Tanvi Chaudhary. She says, what about companies that have started 5 years into business? How does negotiation work for them?
So if you're 5 years into the business, then you're not starting, you're not bootstrapping. You're well into the business and you have your, you will have your P&Ls and the balance sheets available with you. Do the free cash flow method, do the DCF method, get the value of your company. Get both the values done. One is the negotiated value. You fix a particular price and keep that aside and do the valuation based on the basic discounted cash flow method. Get a valuation or any other method that suits you. If you are into research and development, you do something just very new, then under different methods, you do the valuation. Keep the value. Both the negotiated price and the discounted cash flow price, arrive at an average. This is how you should be in a position to get the value that you should put to the investors.
Right. So the next question is from Mr. Vijay Thakkar. He says CureFit, which is a digital startup company into wellness and health, has been burning cash and has a negative cash flow. How are they still able to attract investors in such a business scenario?
See,
similar to the Flipkart one.
But growth, the next growth is going to come from these wellness businesses or edtech businesses or video conferencing businesses, and all these are booming businesses because they would have projected a future cash flow at a stage where they become, their brand becomes synonymous with us. Like Apple is a brand, Apple is synonymous with us, Google is synonymous with us. So people will get accustomed to it. It is what they are driving people to do for which they are burning cash. And they know to what level they want to burn cash and how early they want to make a profit. For them, it is only fitness. Fitness is going to be the very important, going to play a very important role. And they will have projected the cash flow for say next 20 years with certainties and uncertainties in place. We don't recommend 20 years, but that is how they work. They would have assessed the market, total accessible market of so many young population, aging population. So many people will age by this time. And by the time they age, they need better cares or better fitness levels to upkeep in them. So they would have projected the revenue based on the age of the population. That is how it depends. The metrics of valuation for every company depends. For CureFit, it would be based on the, for fitness, it would be based on the aging population or it would be based on any other factor. Flipkart was based on number of users, number of active users on the platform and how many orders were they placing. Every business, one thing is very critical, lifetime value of the customer. I have not put it in my slide, but I'm just giving it as an answer. What is the lifetime value of a customer? Lifetime value of a customer is total purchase the customer is going to make throughout the lifetime of your company. For example, I make 100 purchases from say BizX, 200 purchases from say Franchise India for the say for the next 10 years. That is my lifetime. All companies would have estimated the lifetime value of the customers and how recurring their business is. If the business is recurring and it's fitness business, you want to go to gym every alternate day or every day, it's a recurring business. The flow is going to happen. And people are going to invest in health. So the valuations could have been driven up by that. And the cash burn that they are doing is a planned cash flow to acquire customers. There's something called as customer acquisition cost. They would have done the maths for this. They would have done the cash flows for this. They would have projected that this could be my customer acquisition cost for acquiring a customer and paying this much. Like say what Google Pay did, they gave scratch cards, they gave so many things to you. How many subscribers are there now? That is the customer acquisition cost. The benefit of it is they get the data. The data of all the customers are with them, people have to continue with them, even if the charge excess you're going to pay. There are multiple factors that go into how the drivers work for them. For industry-wise, you see, for example, a company in tech is different from a company in say healthcare segment, because your life cycle of a tech company is only 20 years. The entire life cycle of tech company is 20 years. But whereas a life cycle of an say a fitness company could be 50 years, because it is dependent on the aging population. Nobody is going to change. Fitness is going to remain fitness as long as humans are there. So these are the factors that drive valuation. These are the factors. How they did it? It's pure negotiation. They would have negotiated a particular price. This is the price. This is the cash flow. This is my customer acquisition cost. This is what I expect in 2025 the Indian market to be. In organized healthcare sector, the thing to be. That is how they would have done. Losses does not matter. And given this COVID context, all investors are now pushing every startup for profitability. There is a famous Rakesh Jhunjhunwala quote saying that I don't understand how Flipkart works. Seriously, nobody knows how Flipkart works. They're burning cash. But only thing is that the valuation for driving happens based on the future value of the technology. And are they going to be the only player? Are they going to be monopoly or an oligopoly? Two, three players are only going to be there in the segment. Everybody else will die. Like it happened with Snapdeal, like it happened with so many companies. So it depends on, at 2030, I'm the only player. I'm the only two players that are there. They would bet a premium for it.
Very well explained. So I guess we'll take two, three more questions and then we'll just wrap it up. One question is from Mr. Varun Jindal. He says, does it reduce your chances of getting funded if a company is 10 years old but recently profitable but wishes to get more funding for growing exponentially?
If you're a 10-year-old business and you are making, you're bootstrapping your business, you're growing your business, and if the scalability is proven, say for example, be it Flipkart, be it Cultfit, one factor that fits them is scalability. You see, they can have exponential number of customers, paying customers. They can have exponential number of orders. If you're able to demonstrate through your business plan that you have an exponential growth and there is a viable business option available, viable business exit available to the investor, they would definitely invest in you.
Okay, so the next question is from Mr. Akshay Raina. He says, what happens when after the completion of the exit period of the investor, the company is not able to return the agreed returns to the investor in that case?
The company is not returning anything. The next investor, the founder's role could be to talk to the next investor. That is, for example, I am an investor in your company. As a founder, you should look for the next investor. Say, for example, a PE firm, a venture capital firm. From the angel level, you move on to the seed level, to move on to the venture level, to PE level. You have to go out, explore market, get new investors coming in. For instance, Paytm got Warren Buffett on the board. You have to go and explore the market. You have to get the next exit feasibility should be made for the investors that have already invested in the company. If you're not able to get that exit, if you're not able to get that exit for any reasons, investors have factored everything in. As I told you in my slide, there's something for a risk that we take, the beta risk, that we try and capture that one, but it is not 100% possible. All investors go with it for calculation that only 1 or 2 in 10 companies will survive. 1 in 10 will survive. So their returns that is expected from one company is going to be exponential for them because they're going to fund 9 failed startups. So that is how an investor would look at it. And that is how you should look at it.
Last question now. It's from Miss Seema Purwar. She says, what is equity with rights and whether it makes sense to give 5% equity to landlords for a cafe for physical presence?
5%, this is called as a revenue share that you give to them. You need not have to give them equity share. You can give them a revenue share. Every multiplex or every complex, for example, you have any mall, there is an agreement wherein they would collect a percentage of your sales as their, apart from the rental lease income, they collect this as a percentage of the sales or percentage of the profits, whichever way it works. It is better if you are running a cafe that you tell them for using the premise, you pay them a particular lease rental and a percentage either of your sales or of your profit. It is a general industry norm. There is no such thing as should you give 5%, 2%. It is negotiated. And there are going to be cases where you are able to negotiate at 0%. If you are running into a business, do not give out stake in the company. Try and, out of, say, if you make a sale of 100 rupees, 5% include their cost in it, and then prepare an agreement accordingly. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. So I guess we'll just wrap up the session now. Thank you so much, Viswanathan. It was absolutely great having you here, and thanks for all the information and your insights. I am confident that it added value to all the attendees' lives, and I hope they can apply it to their businesses as well. Thank you to all the attendees for being part of this webinar. If you still have any questions, any concerns, please email me and I will try my best to help you if you still have any questions. Mr. Ajit, again, we were not able to understand your question, but again, if you just email that to me, I'll make sure it reaches Mr. Viswanathan and we'll see what we can do about that. Anything you would like to say?
Thank you, Sonali. Thank you all. I think the things were more informative to you. Some topics might have been more... you might not have understood what was being said there because it was more of a this one there, expert level thing there. But if you have understood the basic financial things and what is necessity from a valuation perspective, I've done my job. But I just want to conclude that, you know, have this thing in mind, how to cope with COVID, how to survive COVID is very important for all startups. How we are going to adopt technology and how we are going to survive this COVID, how we are going to do your replanning. Take this formula, it's a very interesting formula that was shared. It's a very good thing. Just focus on what is being said there. Take your decisions. Come out of this COVID. Once this we get into this recessionary or depression mode, economic depression, there are going to be new billionaires and millionaires being. Just have that hope. Survive this. Apply this formula. And you're good to go with that. That's great. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
I was able to do justice to what I was.
Yeah, of course. Of course. It was absolutely great. Thank you so much once again. We'll see you next time. We are planning to make this valuation a series. So in the next webinar, we'll try to cover more topics in more details. So if you're interested for that, please let me know. And please also check out all our other webinars as well. We have one this Saturday, which is also about crisis innovation strategy. So if you need any other information about that, please get in touch with me. Thank you once again, everyone. Have a great day ahead. Stay home and stay safe. Thank you.